follow the places, wondering where they all disappear. I didn't ponder the question too long. I was hungry and went out for a bite. Ran into a chunk.
Okay, well, here we are again to another exciting edition of Neighborhood Training. This week we got kind of a long one to go here. We'll try to work our way through it pretty quick, and that's the Seacoast Shores Boulevard, Seacoast Shores neighborhood here, this long peninsula here. And, you know, we're talking about peninsula here that's, you know, nearly about a mile and three quarters long. So, and it's very well populated, a lot of small lots, as we're well aware of. I know everybody's been down there quite a bit. It is, well, I would kind of categorize as a neighborhood in transition. There's a lot of, there was a tremendous amount of seasonal cottages and so forth down there, and since then, been making the transition from seasonal to year-round, just like a lot of neighborhoods in Falmouth, like Pinecrest, Maravista, and so forth. And I think we're going to continue to see that trend as time goes on. It's pretty amazing to me that in, you know, we would characterize the houses that are right on Seacoast as Boulevard itself as, you know, being far away from the water and not that attractive, and the ones that are right on the water are very attractive and very, you know, very nice. But if we look at this, you know, how many people can live less than a quarter mile to the water? You know, a tenth of a mile from the water. You know, and just that short of a walk down there. These people along right along the boulevard are actually pretty lucky, and there's a lot of opportunity, I think, you know, over the years for Seacoast to really develop into a much more year-round community. There are a lot of roads here in Seacoast, so we're going to have to work on it. It's pretty pretty flat peninsula as far as the topography, and, you know, we have the two bodies of water, a river, and, well, actually, and the Washburn's on one side. So we'll kind of work our way down there. And of course, there's only one way in or out, so that's why we have so many accidents here right at Seacoast and 28, because all these people are going to come in and go out. And right on to 28. So, and I don't believe they're ever going to build a bridge across here, so that's just the way it's going to have to be. All right, going to work our way down Seacoast, and we should really look at this because we won't expect everybody, obviously, to remember where every road is. But I think in Seacoast, you should be able to pick up the gist of most of the roads in there, to at least say they're in Seacoast, and, you know, maybe you can pick up some of the dividing roads like Bayside, you know, whether it's south of Bayside or north of Bayside, and then obviously the difference between Edgewater Drive West being on the west part of towards Falmouth, and the east side being towards Mashpee. The other thing that we hope that everybody would pick up is that on these roads that go all the way across, like Hartwell, that the low numbers are towards the Falmouth side, towards the west side. So if we're going to, you know, 7 or 11 or 15, whichever one of these roads it is, then we would turn right off of the boulevard. If we're looking at the numbers, say in the 30 to 40, 50 range, we would turn left off the boulevard. So, you know, just a little other thing. And then, not to say that it's absolutely precise, but sometimes we can look at the numbers on Edgewater Drive West and East as being similar to that as is on the boulevard. So kind of give ourselves a jump start. Like here we're talking about 58, and 58 is roughly around the same area between one or two streets anyway of where it is on the boulevard. And the other thing we're pointing out is we look at the hydrants here. We have a 1500 gallon a minute hydrant. Where did that go? All right, 1500 gallon a minute hydrant, 1300 gallon a minute hydrant. I don't know what they are way down at the end, but I would. It's not a, maybe a looped main as far as Edgewater Drive east and west. Hopefully that's some planning that went into the water system down there, but no guarantee. We do have water throughout the whole peninsula, as you see here, so that's a real benefit. And all these lots are real tiny, so the houses are close together. We do, you know, I think they're far enough apart that we would not have any, you know, auto exposure or radiant heat issue, but that is something, you know, as these houses get bigger and bigger, you know, something that we are going to have to be aware of. To do some protection lines on. I don't know why this map is going so slow here, but we'll kind of work through it. I just wanted to see if some of these hydrants down here are a different flow. We'll just wait 1 second. 1250, so that's not bad as we get down further. So. All right, wait for this map to fill in here. I don't know why it's taking so long. But we should also be able to tell that Marshall Drive and Ashley Drive and Churchill and Winchester are all towards the beginning of Seacoast. So we should be familiar with that. You know, Seacoast, Shores Boulevard, Ashley, Marshall, Churchill, and Winchester. And we will also, with the exception of Ashley right here, that all these roads go all the way through. So almost, we're going to touch on that as we go down, almost down to Croydon, the roads go all the way across. Once we get, there's about three or four streets up by Croydon that are a different name of a street on the Edgewater Drive east side. So. You know, Ashley, Marshall, Churchill, Winchester, Hartwell, Atwater. Let's see, we get up here. Okay. And Harvard, Yale. You know, maybe we can remember that as far as colleges, that Harvard and Yale are pretty close together. I don't know too many other tricks to try and remember this. None of them, they're not in alphabetical order. So Harvard and Yale, Pershing, Columbus, and Hamden, Sachem, and Berkeley. And as we can still see up in here that the numbers are still relatively the same, 179, 187, 190, 182. So there's not a big disparity there, but you know, it's just one of those little cues. So Berkeley and Seaspray, then we get up to the Croydon area right around in here. Just between Croydon and Bayside is where there's different names of the roads on the east side. So it's Ingleside, Concord, and Plymouth are over here, where Croydon, Pembroke, and Newton are on the other side. But once we get up to Bayside, and one other thing to point out is Bayside is where the beach is, that the kind of the association beach right over here for the residents, and it's also the closest point over to Washburn's. So the water does move through here a little quick. Sometimes people try to swim across, and it's easily doable. I mean, there's not a great flow of water through there, but also as far as if we do have, you know, if fires over in Washburn's, this is the quickest ferrying point across. It's pretty accessible. So we have Bayside, Winthrop, because in the 40s they used Washburn's Island, the military did, for a training session, and there was a bridge from Bayside to Washburn's. That's why there's that kind of a man-made little peninsula. Winthrop, Ellsworth, Ovington, Woodside. We should, you know, kind of think that those roads are beyond Bayside. They're about half to three-quarters of the way down. Fairfield, Pine Rock, Amphibian, Knollwood. And now we start getting into the end of Seacoast, the southern part of it. And we get into a much more seasonal area way down in the end. Fisher. And then we get Fisher and Linwood, Terrace, Ipswich Drive, Ormond, Fenwick, Fairview Lane. Now remember, Fairview is also down in Falmouth Center. So there's a little difference in lane and Fairview Ave, Fairview Lane. And still see the numbers are relatively the same, 69 and 369, 370, 374, 380. And they're a little different, but they're roughly in the same area. And then we get down to the very end of Seacoast Shores Boulevard. Now, this house here, 459, is, let's see if I can bring this up here. This is really shows the differences that are on Seacoast. We have a building like this right on the tip of Seacoast. We have a 1,300 gallon a minute hydrant there, but we also have this good sized building here. Once again, probably about a 3,000 square foot, but it also has a stone exterior. I would say it's a wood frame building, but with the stone exterior facade, probably not using this for any structural integrity. But that's the house we have on the end, as opposed to this type of house, which is what we see often down at the northern end of Seacoast, these little seasonal cottages that have been added on over time. And then we have also down at this end here, one of these, this house here, which is pretty large, you know, with a large overhang here. I don't know whether, you know, this is a renovation or just an addition to the house, but you know, kind of an interesting design. And this house here is rather interesting. It's kind of reminiscent of what the cottages were. This is actually, at least on the exterior of the house, these are all logs. I don't know if they're totally a log home or whether it's just a log facade, but you know, it's a nice little old cottage. And fortunately, or fortunately, depends on your outlook, these are being torn down and bigger places are being built. And then we have another place right here that's within vicinity of that log house. We have this place here, which is actually located, I believe, it might be right over in here, I believe. But anyway, so I mean, that's quite a place there. And of course we have the clubhouse here, which is down towards the end of Seacoast. I believe we go right over in here, 7 Fairview, I believe this is the clubhouse here, and they apparently are going to be building a new clubhouse, much larger one. So, be interesting to see what comes up with that. And this is an odd looking house. You got a metal roof, different type of construction. So that's just a little different than what we're going to get into. This is kind of an overgrown place. I don't even know if it's occupied. I tried to get some sense of whether it was occupied or not, and I really don't know whether this is just a summer house or whether someone is actually living inside, more hermit type, but we got little bushes growing up top, so you know, we can't presume that it's unoccupied just from looking at the exterior, but it'd be a good guess. This is also some of the things that we're running into. Here we talked about the tear downs. Here's a little Cape cottage right on the water. And it's, quickly going to be torn down and renovated. So that's how fast this neighborhood is going. And I think in years past, we used to see places being burned down in order to be renovated, but we're not seeing that currently anyway. This is the Bayside, the end of Bayside, Washburn's over there, and that close point there with the Association Beach. Just wanted to point that out. And we'll take a quick shot in this. We already saw that house, as I mentioned before. I mean, that's probably, you know, a good 5,000 square foot house. And we already looked at the clubhouse, that's good, and we've got one more here. Well, this is one down by Marshall Drive on the Edgewater Drive west side. So just the types of things that we're running into. I know that years not too far past, we had basement fires that were illegal apartments in places like this where they do have the drop-off. And I think, top of my head, I can't remember who it was, but they did grab a guy out of there. Unfortunately, it already passed by due to the fire, but, grab somebody out of the basement, the fire there. So that's something we need to be aware of. You know, and these usually run pretty good as far as fires are concerned, and we don't get a good size up from the first look at the house, and that's why we try to do a 360 if we can. Okay, and let's see, we've already looked at that, we've done the roads. This is really, I'm trying to cut this real short because I know that there's just a lot to cover on Seacoast, and you know, we don't want to cover the highlights, and hopefully, you know, we can work on remembering what we have down there. Wood frame single family dwellings, like I say, except for the illegal apartments that may exist, I didn't see any multi-family apartments. 1,000 to 4,000, I don't know, I'd probably up that to 5,000 square foot. Was really started in the 50s, the mid 50s, the early 50s, a little small cottages. You notice that we don't have, this is a lot different than what we saw down in Minot. I mean, Minot had some of those two or three story shingle style large places, and we have in different other parts of town. This is why it's important to know the neighborhoods, because in other parts of town we have some very, like in Silver Beach for instance, very large. Megansett, the same thing. Seasonal area, but totally different type of housing. Seacoast Shores was a seasonal area, but it was all a bunch of little cottages. I would equate it to being like the working man's vacation land. Everybody was able to pick up a little cottage on Seacoast. So full hydrants everywhere. I mean, there are hydrants everywhere, pretty good flow. Be aware, we should already be aware of Edgewater Drive East and West, and also the Boulevard, the numbering system. put these little cues up here to the low numbers, we turn right off Seacoast, the higher numbers, we turn left, roughly around the 40 or 50 number mark is where it breaks. Ashley Drive, all of these are done sequentially here as the roads go all the way through. And then we have that area where just between Bayside and Croydon that we have roads that are different numbered on the other side of the road. And we should remember that Marshall, Churchill, Winchester, you know, maybe even up to Harvard or down, you know, the lower end, the northern end, you know, Harvard and Yale are together. We get into the middle around Croydon, Bayside area is usually around the middle of Seacoast. Maybe Pembroke and Newton we can remember as being, or these are being in the middle. These are more maybe towns in Massachusetts, Pembroke, Concord, Plymouth, Newton as being in the middle. And then down at the end we would, you know, be able to maybe remember that Knollwood, Fisher, Linwood, Terrace, Ipswich, Ormond, maybe those are down at the end. But then our response distances from station 5, now remember that's about a mile and three quarter peninsula. Now these distances are only taken down to Bayside, which is halfway down. I took it at 50 Bayside, which is right near Seacoast Shores Boulevard and right on Bayside. And I did that because we need to always be cognizant of that 6 minute response time, whether it be for fires or for rescue. And this is an area about halfway down Seacoast that we can reach in 6 minutes from station 5, about 2.3 miles roughly from station 5. Now here's the difference. Station 1, 6.2, it depends on traffic and so forth, but you know, we're looking well over 10 minutes to get there. So station 5 personnel are going to have about 6 minutes or more to wait for their second due engine. So you have to begin to do things right and set things up for the you know, the progress of the incident. Station 4 is really only a mile away in distance from Seacoast from headquarters. So when it seems like West Falmouth is far away, and granted it's 7.3 miles, but it's only a mile further away than headquarters. So they'll be arriving shortly thereafter. So that kind of wraps up what we wanted to cover on Seacoast. I hope that you were able to get something out of this. Been looking at maybe the northern third of Seacoast, the middle third, and the southern third, and pick up some of those little cues to find our way around. All right. Well, in the meantime, till we meet next time, stay safe and eat healthy.